Why should he? Welcome along to the football show. So lots of good stuff for you. Later on this hour, we'll talk to Nicky Bandini about Serie A, where the Milan derby is on this weekend. It's first against second. Juventus in action tomorrow in the Champions League there in fourth. Antonio Conte's escaped punishment for giving the Juventus president the finger. And of course, there was the Lukaku's Latan tussle a couple of weeks ago. So Nicky Bandini will join us and fill us in on everything. It's second half just starting in Leipzig, where it's nil all between Liverpool and Leipzig. Liverpool, a lot of good chances in that first half, but nothing to show for it. Meanwhile, two goals at the Nou Camp, where it's one goal apiece between Barcelona and PSG. And Messi, who has scored, by the way, now 12 goals in 11 games, scored a penalty. Excuse me. And Kylian Mbappe scored the equaliser after 32 minutes. So we're still 1-1 second half starting at the Nou Camp. Dan McDonnell back with us evening.
Evening, Joe. How are things?
Very well. So we've a few bits to get through. We should start with the Champions League coverage in RTE this evening. Damien Duff, obviously, as he has been for some time, is an analyst. He was alongside Richie Sadlier and Darren Maloney was there. Needless to say, Dan, first question was about Damien Duff's decision to step away from the Irish setup. So let's have a listen.
Well, listen, Darren, I appreciate that you have to ask, but I don't really have a lot to say in the matter. I know I've made the right decision because not one day has passed where I've regretted it. I know it's not ideal for the manager, but at the same time, I guess it's a chance for him to bring in a better coach than me. He's done it already on the goalkeeping side. He's brought in Dean Kiely, a great guy. He'll bring a great energy to the squad and a top coach who's obviously coaching at the top level in the Premier League every week. And at the end of the day, the only person that's lost out really is me by walking away. You're soon forgotten, so staff, players, I'm sure they don't have a problem with it now. It's all water under the bridge. I've given up because I've walked away. The chance to represent my country, which is a massive, massive honour. The chance to coach elite players, which doesn't come around very often. And I've probably lost a lot of focus as well, which a lot of ex-players will tell you, you need that in your life. So, but listen, I felt strongly about things and I would have been unhappy with myself if I stayed. Mm. Simple as that.
Okay, no, look, you're uncomfortable talking about yourself in this manner, but you can understand why people wanted to know why you were leaving.
Yes, I do. I'd be the same. I know football people want to know, but at the same time, I'm uncomfortable talking about it now, but I just want to keep it private. And even when you guys asked me, 2 weeks ago to do the show tonight, you told me then, oh, we're going to have to ask you. And I was like, oh, really? But listen.
Yes, really.
But I can't hide away me house forever because I've left the FAI. No way. And people will say, I've let my country down. I've let nobody down here. I'll continue to dedicate myself to Irish football in a different capacity by coaching young players and improving young players, hopefully improving myself as well. But all I've ever done since I wore the Irish shirt from 14, under 15, is dedicate myself to Irish football, and I've never let my country down, and I'll continue to work for Irish football in a different way.
Okay. He ain't giving us nothing.
It didn't really clear. You couldn't describe it as Damien Duff clears things up about his Irish accent, could you? No. I don't think you could put that. You couldn't put that headline on it. And there's probably enough there, as we've discussed this topic before, for everyone to take away the interpretation they want to take away from it to some degree. Mm. But it was light on detail. And listen, TV, Joe, I don't know what sort of time constraints they were under in terms of the discussion and the debate. But I don't think it's unfair to say you would have liked to hear one or two more questions. But, there but for the grace of God and all of that. You don't know what the sort of situation was with that. But I suppose there's one or two things you probably would have wanted to directly ask, I would say. And if Damien Duff ever goes down that road again and appears somewhere or other, and I don't think he really needs to do that. He's not someone who's going to be doing promotional gigs just for a few quid. That's not really his style, to be honest. But there'd probably be a more direct line of questioning taking on certain stuff, I would have thought.
Yeah, I would think considerable time pressure and also an added pressure to preview this game, which they're on to show, and Liverpool fans will be really into. I know you would argue Irish fans are more interested in Damien Duff than they are, but there would still be a sense that, well, we have to do some kind of coverage of the game. And also, I would think they have talked about this a bit before going on air, and based on what he said just there, Damien Duff would have made it very clear to everybody at RTE, I'm not answering these questions. I'm not going into it. You can ask me over and over again. I'm not doing it. So it's up to you guys. You can keep asking me. So I'd say it was a difficult situation all around. And, you know, maybe there's a duty of care to somebody that you're employing as well who's saying, look, I don't really want to get into this. Can you, you know, do you want to sacrifice your relationship with Damien Duff for the next year or two if you're the broadcaster? So it's tricky. It's very tricky. I mean, it's disappointing, though. You really would like him to just say what the issue was.
Yeah, no, exactly. And yeah, and I don't know, like, would he have answered more? Maybe he would have, you know, but like, we don't know. I suppose, yeah, like, I think he was so sort of deliberate to some degree in the words he chose that I don't think he could, like, I think you'd be putting too much stock on what was said to, like, to analyze it too much, yeah. You know, if you know what I mean. Oh, listen, like, you know, it's a couple of comments about bigging up Dean Kiley and whatnot. Like, it's, I think it's reasonably well known at this stage that, like, he obviously had a bit of a fallout with Alan Kelly, and probably no love lost there.
Well, it was interesting. Probably, his wording was that, you know, Stephen Kenny will go out and get a better coach than me. He's already done that on the goalkeeping side of things with Dean Kiley. People are saying, "Whoa, well, that's, I mean, that is big." I think that was just the way the words flowed together as opposed to a concerted effort to say Dean Kiley's much better coach than Alan Kelly, by the way, you know.
It could be.
I think he was just making the point he's replaceable, and, you know, he'll probably get a better coach than me, and look, he's already got Dean Kiley in, and you can suddenly put it together the way it came out of his mouth, as if, you know, Duff shoots down quality of Kelly's coaching, and I think that would be a bit unfair.
I don't think he's shooting down the quality of his coaching, but, you know, he knows what he's saying too in his own way. You can sort of take things in your own way, but he has that way of, he has that delivery, Duff, doesn't he? Like, when he was on RT previously about the video gate thing, you know, he sort of speaks with the head down almost. And he says, you know, what was the reference previously about, you know, the video? Some people have a problem with that. And it's just left there in a particular way. That's just how he opts to do things. But, you know, he does feel, like, the one thing I would say is it obviously probably has bothered him. I think the suggestion that he let people down, he let anyone down. I watch as Liverpool score here, that he's actually bothered anyone and let them down, you know, that he's let his country down. There has been some commentary to that end, so that clearly probably did irk him to some degree. And he did also suggest that obviously there were things that he felt about strongly, that he hasn't just walked away because he had another job lined up or something like that. Like, you know, it's sort of clarified he's definitely leaving on a point of his principles and what those principles are and what caused it. Clearly, he wasn't happy with how certain things were handled.
Just in case anyone was ever under the illusion Dan McDonnell's a Liverpool fan, he's obviously proven he's not this evening, the way he casually mentioned, oh, Liverpool have scored here. So they most certainly have away to Leipzig. 52 minutes on the clock. It's build up down the left-hand side. Oh, it's a Leipzig player who plays Mo Salah in. It's a really loose, almost blind pass to his defensive colleague. And it's not even an accurate pass because it goes in behind his defensive colleague. And who's there? Only Mo Salah. And he's coming in from the right-hand side. So he turns it onto his left foot. You think for all the world like he's going to hit it into the far corner, curl it into the far corner. Instead, he passes it straight into the near corner. Jurgen Klopp fist bump. Liverpool 1-0 up and away goal as well. Calamity in the Leipzig defence. They concede a lot of goals, Leipzig, more than any other team currently in the knockout stages thus far in the competition.
Are you suggesting Nathan Murphy would have delivered that news with a bit more joy in his voice? He would have just, like, abandoned all, whatever it was, train of thought and going to comment. But I mean, like, I don't know, who do you have on that gets excited about Liverpool goals?
I suppose.
Clearly there's people on who do that. Who are those people?
Well, I mean, they would have given a degree more than Damien Duff said this. Liverpool have just scored a crucial goal in the knockout stages of the Champions League.
Well, I was actually just referring to something out the corner of my eye and trying to keep my train of thought, but I didn't realise it was going to be a commentary on the sort of slightly downbeat delivery of it. I apologise.
No, it's okay. So listen, look, on this Duff
professional
thing.
Professional, I think it's called, actually.
A professional. What a pro. What a pro. So listen, on this Duff thing, we can drag the backside out of this and analyse every word. The fact is, he has said nothing tonight, and so that's just really...
That's the fairest. You know what? I think you're probably right. We've managed to still get 5 to 6 minutes out of it.
Didn't even merit that.
But no, I think, as I said, the one thing I would say definitely, and I'm pretty sure that this will be borne out, like, with the Ireland stuff over the last while, there's obviously been different views around certain things and stories. And I think people will take... you know, people will take from that what they want to take from it.
If you were of the opinion that Damien Duff was sorry to leave Stephen Kenny behind but just could no longer stand the side of the FAI, tonight does nothing to dissuade you of that view.
No, absolutely. But there's some people on the other side could say, well, he didn't come out and give the manager a strong backing, did he? So I can understand how someone could say that as well. Mm. You know, so like it's but really, then you're going down the road of reading too much into words. He pretty much decided it was private. And he wasn't going to go into it. But I'm sure at some stage in the future, he probably will. And that might answer some of those questions. Everything else is probably theories or as I said, there was some well-sourced information on how he was feeling about things, but obviously some people need to hear him say that stuff, and I understand that.
As in, people who think maybe there was a falling out with Stephen Kenny will still be able to say, well, he made a point of not backing Kenny in any great way.
That could be, you can see that. And then, you know, his issues with the FAI, like, you know, he did make some reference to he's left the FAI, but he'll continue to serve Irish football and all this type of stuff. But, like, Damien Duff is his own man. He very much is his own man. I think anyone who knows him, I wouldn't claim to know him at all. People who do know him would say that he's very much his own man. And I think he's taken a decision. I don't think a lot of other people would have probably left in the circumstances, but he's opted to do so. And, you know, listen, I'm sure he'll be back in some shape or form. Like, I don't think, you know, this is the end of hearing Duff in the discussion around the Irish team or anything like that. I think, yeah, there's a lot more to come in his football actual coaching journey, not just the punditry side of things.
Have you heard more about his decision since we last spoke about it, whenever that was, a couple of months ago?
In what sense? Like, just why he left?
Yeah, or what's happened to him?
No, I mean, I've probably written a fair bit of stuff, and I've probably come round to the conclusion, and probably come round to, you know, various discussions with people and stuff, that I actually just don't think there's one distinct thing. I don't think there's one, like, this is the reason, you know, like, this is it, you know, this is like the smoking gun sort of piece of information as to why it was. And I think, you know, I don't think there was a big fallout with Stephen Kenny or anything like that. But at the same time, I don't believe it looks great for Stephen Kenny that he's left. And I think that's probably a fair point of view, as I tried to keep my composure as Liverpool raced through on goal to score again. But I think that there's certainly layers to it. But I've no doubt, and listen, it's been reported widely, there's nothing unusual in saying it, that there was a dispute of sorts with Alan Kelly. And maybe he might have wanted that dispute even to be handled differently, I wonder. You know, there's certainly a feeling there that if Alan Kelly had left first, what might have happened. But really, I don't know. I'm not sure if I want to place too much stock into that, but that's certainly an opinion that exists out there, you know? But it's,
I feel like Darren Maloney here, for God's sake.
I don't know, because I honestly can't say it. I can't say something with absolute sort of stubborn, like, this is the reason confidence that I wouldn't claim to, because, okay, like, you know, because to be honest, like a lot of people, there's probably two versions. People have heard different things, different versions of events,
yeah,
of people. And people would say, and I think there was probably a combination of factors that I don't think, listen, there was no doubt he was not happy with Videogate and all of that. I think that's accepted by everyone, and that was bad. Like, the investigation shouldn't have happened in the way that it did. And that, I don't think that part of it really can be disputed by anybody. How that led to him actually eventually going, I mean, is there aspects that have fallen out he would have probably wanted handled differently from all sides? Possibly so.
Okay.
Possibly.
So you're hearing different things from different people, I'm guessing.
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Very much so.
Yeah. Mane scored the second goal for Liverpool, 58 minutes. Again, just found himself. I mean, this is like kind of schoolboy stuff where he's got half the pitch wide open and he's just running through on goal and runs 20 metres with the ball and strokes it home. And that's that. So it's 2-0 Liverpool suddenly on the hour mark, which is an unbelievable result. And they're dominant. They're going at Leipzig in droves now. You guess, I presume Leipzig will feel they have to come out and score one tonight. So no better team than Liverpool to pick them off. Front three looking good form. I mean, this will be a quick way to salvage their season if they can have a run in the Champions League, needless to say.
Yeah, definitely so. I mean, there's no doubt, like, didn't see the build-up to the second goal like the first. But Leipzig have left themselves wildly exposed. You know, it looks like almost like Liverpool at Leicester at the weekend. You concede one, and then you lose your composure completely, and you concede another type of goal that you shouldn't concede. in like a brief, you know, frantic spell of activity. But yeah, I mean, it's obviously a bit of a weird when you say it's an away win, but it's obviously in Hungary. It's like not, say, your normal Champions League tie as such. You know, you've gone away to the Lions Den or something and got this big away win. But the nature of the comp, you know, knockout football and the firepower they have, you can see how, like, they've been a bit inconsistent of late, but when they've still produced good performances in the midst of an overall slump. So, it can do something for them. And even just, like, you know, to take the heat out of the home aspect of it, you know, if they could even just come back with a cushion and just take some, I don't know. It just feels like they just sort of need to take the pressure out of situations generally. And even like this was felt like a quite a big game for them tonight. And if they can sort of get through this tie without too much stress and strife, it might just give them a chance to sort of, you know, just to take a breath and regroup a small bit and refocus.
Remiss of me not to mention that James McClean is going to be on OTB AM tomorrow at 9 a.m. So that's well worth tuning in for. It would be great to hear from him in the midst of this storm. Significant, Dan, that the PFA came out and supported him. I don't think they really did that before. Certainly not like this. The FAI came out as well. We touched on this in the news round. I guess this time around, it's very similar to what happened maybe a year ago when he was driving home from training and listening to, I think it was Talk Sport, and heard much discussion about discrimination and the Black Lives Matter movement and thought, well, I'm on board with all of that, but why is the discrimination that I've been subject to for the last 9 years of my career not talked about in terms remotely close to this? And he went on Talk Sport and spoke about it. And a year on, somebody private messaged him saying, amongst other things, that they would burn, you know, don't make me burn your house down and everyone in it. And McClean has said, look, the Irish this and the IRA that are water off a duck's back, but the death threat stuff, it crosses a line. And again, he was just throwing it out to the public. Why is this not a scandal? And I think this time around he has had a more official response, I think.
Yeah, no, I think so. I mean, I do think it was probably this, you know, the statement by his wife Erin that probably even seemed to bring it to another level this time too. You know, she obviously put out a sort of a lengthy post yesterday, and that seemed to almost gain legs. And like that, listen, whether it's coincidental or not, you know, that statement came out before a lot of the other statements, you know, from sort of official organizations and even Stoke today and so on. So, I think probably provided a sort of a human side to it. Not that there hasn't been a human side to anything James McClean has said about it, but like James McClean's sort of, I don't think he would have any problem admitting this. Like, he would obviously have a sort of a combative streak, you know, and what he's done often in the past is he's taken some abuse and he's reacted to it, and that's his probably way of dealing with it. And people obviously would deal with things in different ways. Whereas obviously what Erin did, his wife did, was to probably, you know, detail the story behind it and, you know, what it's like for people at home who are probably, you know, trying to sort of interpret some of the, you know, the seriousness of some stuff that is said. Because I think we all know that, yeah, like there's loads of, you know, people who will just type stuff from behind a screen and stuff and be very brave in that format, you know, anonymously or whatever. But she did make the point in her statement that there was a particular game, you know, where someone had said, you know, they were going to bring a gun to this match. And, you know, she's sitting at home watching this game thinking, well, what if that person was right? You know, what if that person wasn't telling, you know, wasn't just sort of telling tall tales as such? Now, I'm sure, like, as much as you're rational and you think, no, that can't happen, that can't be true, like, and it's easy for us to say that from this sort of remove here, thinking, no, no one would do that. If it's your husband, like, if it's the father of your three kids or whatever, then even if there's 1% of you thinking, well, actually, maybe that could happen, you know, can you imagine? Like, it's just not normal. And, like, this is the, you know, these are the threats that, or comments they're facing all the time, you know. And the one, the comment this week that sort of brought this on was someone saying, you know, I'll burn your house and everyone inside it. And again, you know, if you've got a young family and stuff, that takes on a very different sort of complexion, I suppose. And I think she was making the point that their kids are getting a bit older now. I'm not sure what age they are, but they're certainly, you know, they're they're sort of getting to the stage where obviously they'll, you know, if they heard a discussion or heard things said, they would very much understand it. And there comes a point where it probably has to stop. It's a strange one now at the moment, really, of course, because we have closed doors football for the last period of time. And like prior to that, we actually did have an attempt to address stadium abuse of James McClean, which is like every week. Like I've been to games in England where like Millwall away and stuff, where it's just start to finish, 90 minutes, just tirade aimed in the direction of a player. And there was, I think it was at Barnsley and maybe Huddersfield, that action taken against him. There was one game where I think he stops play before a corner just to highlight it. And obviously we've gone into this world now, obviously with no fans at the moment at games, but clearly it's continued. And it does appear that finally, you know, organisations who in the past just sort of probably turned a blind eye to it or certainly didn't actively engage with it are now suddenly realising we maybe should have been doing more about this over the years. This is not acceptable.
Mm. Yeah, it's very tricky. What do you suspect if fans were back in stadiums and an entire stadium was chanting whatever about McClean could be done about it? This is different to, say, racist abuse, where if somebody was to scream a vitriolic racist comment, you would like to think that, one, that person would be massively in the minority, and two, that those around him or her would look at them with a degree of disgust, and so there would be a degree of social isolation, etc. Whereas nobody has the abuse that's been aimed at McClean remotely on the same level as that. So, you know, if thousands of people are doing it, I'm not quite sure what can be done.
Well, this is it. Like, I've unfortunately, as much as like I'm talking about how the awareness is there, you know, and people seem to be more conscious of it, I've no doubt if stadiums were back open again and, you know, James McClean was playing this weekend away at a championship ground of some description, I'm sure he would get comments that, you know, he would take as, you know, as, you know, sort of to meet the criteria for sort of, you know, for racist abuse or however you want to phrase it, you know, about his nationality or his religion or his background or however you want to interpret it. I know what you're saying. Like, you know, will there be other people saying, no, you can't do that? You know, that won't happen. Is there that way? I don't think so.
No, I'm not sure it's taboo yet, Dan, if you say
I don't know. Listen, I don't believe it is at all, no. To be honest. Like, that's striking a negative tone. But I guess what we did see in the past, like, this went on for years with no consequences for anyone at all. Mm. Like, at all. Like, I'm thinking of the games I was at. Like, you know, it was just routine that this is what happens. Like, McClean, when he gets that abuse. And I think, like, Aaron touched on in our sort of in our note, that there was probably a degree of probably even officialdom thinking, well, you know, he's brought some of that on himself.
Yeah.
I think that could be the only explanation for it, really. That and people thinking, well, listen, you know, a few jibes about being a Paddy this or Irish that, whatever, that's not the same. That's probably the point. And also probably, I think people also think that because someone can be combative in how they approach it, well, then ultimately you can't portray them as a sympathetic figure because they have this shriek and he seems to like embrace it and bite back. But that doesn't change the tone and the nature of the comments that are actually being made. Like, it doesn't change the principle of someone anonymously sending threats to someone's house, you know.
Yeah, just the death threat, you know, which makes this suddenly far more serious, and that's why you think authorities should get involved. You know, it's one thing if he's getting you IRA so-and-so, you Fenian so-and-so, you Paddy, all that stuff, get out of our country.
Mm.
It's really grim. But then when death threats come into it, I mean, authorities have to get involved. They're duty-bound to get involved. It was interesting to see David Myler's tweet, and we mentioned this in the newsroom as well, but people may have missed it. So Myler had condemned the abuse that McClean has taken for years and said he was aware of it for years, and somebody replied to him on Twitter saying, why are you only speaking out now about this and not when you were playing? You knew he was going through this years ago. And Myler quote tweeted that question and said, honestly, I was afraid to get involved. I stood by and watched a friend and teammate get abused time after time and thought to myself, I don't want that aimed towards me and my family, which was incredibly honest, because I think a lot of his teammates would be in the same boat there.
Yeah, I thought that I was very struck by the honesty there. And this is something James McClean has previously addressed in the past, that he felt maybe that, you know, I think he pointed out that you know, some teammates of his were obviously quite active and say around sort of BLM or like sort of awareness of sort of issues pertaining to sort of racism and discrimination and posting stuff on their social media or whatever it might be, and that he'd never really had a public message of support from a teammate. And listen, that's a very valid point to raise, you know, and I've no doubt that a lot of people, for their own reasons, they didn't want their, as you say, they didn't want their family to be exposed to it. Potentially, you never know, like some players could have been thinking, could this have some kind of impact on their career, you know, because there was obviously some clubs who didn't want to sign James McClean and had to deal with a backlash from their fan base when they signed him or, you know, when they were linked with him because of that. And I was sort of thinking about this as well, particularly for Irish players, that like where a lot of the Irish players play, they're not necessarily playing with, say, you know, sort of the super clubs. We have a huge amount of players in London, you know, in those areas. And we have a lot of players, and this was probably where James McClean's issue started initially to some way. Like he didn't wear the poppy when he was at Sunderland, a club that sort of, the town itself has a sort of a link with the army. I think there was people even involved or around the club who had strong links to sort of, you know, the armed forces, and the relationship in certain parts of England would be, you know, and this, even the fan base and the association with sort of certain symbolism would be quite strong. And we'd have a lot of Irish players at clubs like that, you know. You sort of wonder, and this is just me off the top of my head, but like if you had an Irish player at someone like Liverpool, which obviously people talk about Liverpool as a very different, Liverpool even within England has a sort of a different attitude sometimes towards the rest of England. Like if an Irish player in a city with a real Irish background come out and explain their reasons and play for Liverpool, would they have had issues? Like, I just wonder. I'm just speculating off the top of my head.
I think it's an interesting question.
Whereas a lot of the Irish players are at clubs where they'd have real issues if they went down that.
Yeah, the profile of the clubs he's played at, I would suspect, communities still very much a part of the clubs, and they would have strong links to the military as well. Arlo Hanlon was on the show earlier, and he was saying, like, when you're over here, over in England, you realise just the extent to which the relationship with the military is so strong, you know, and that's an issue too. And we shouldn't, it's remiss of us, by the way, not to say that McClean has made missteps along these 9 years. Now, he does not deserve death threats, and I don't think either he deserves the abuse he has received, even aside from death threats. But like his joke, the balaclava with the kids for homeschooling, and it was history.
Ah, yeah, that was it's
ridiculous.
Bad joke gone wrong.
It was a terrible idea, and understandably, there lots of people would find that deeply insensitive on his part. You know, like
I think that was probably an attempt. Like in some respects, it was probably an attempt to an ironic aspect to it to some degree. You know, like he's almost becoming a caricature and probably, you know, sort of poking fun at his own reputation in a certain way.
But equally, but you know, he's been antagonistic lots of times in replies to people who absolutely have been antagonistic to him. And he might say, well, I'm not going to take it and say nothing. But it's fuel. It is fuel. And that's been part of the issue as well. Like there are, you know, Nemanja Matic doesn't seem to attract the same level of scrutiny or attention. But the other thing what I'd really say in McClean's defense about this whole poppy thing is, you know, so Arlo Hanlon was on earlier and he was making the point that, you know, social media is no place for nuance, which of course it isn't, and I agreed with him. I thought it was a very fair point to make. But McLean's reasons for not wearing the poppy aren't rocket science either.
No. Like
they really aren't. This is not, you know, you need to study Irish history at length or read my 5,000-word dissertation on my reasons for not wearing the poppy to even begin to understand my reasons. Like, you can kind of sum it up in a sentence or two, you know? Northern Ireland, British Army there, Bloody Sunday, it's where I'm from.
Yeah, Craig and where he's from.
You've been up there, you did a great piece there. Yeah. Like, you can almost do it in bullet points, and, you know, that's just me. And why that hasn't had any truck. And so, you know, I've pointed out that he's made a few missteps. Equally, he's published an open letter where it eloquently, years ago at Wigan, expressed his rationale, you know, in a very respectful way, And that did him no good either, you know. So I've
it's terrible
that it hasn't managed to permeate the very thick skulls of so many people over there, because his reasons are very simple and they're fair enough.
Yeah, and the one thing I would say about, like, you say the letter at Wigan did him no good. I know what you mean, like, in terms of, say,
Stopping the abuse.
Yeah. I do think, like, off the back of that, I think he probably does have a lot more. I think there's a certain amount of actual media support for him, I think, you know, and certainly in terms of football writers I would deal with in England and stuff, I think they're quite sympathetic. Now, that probably gets lost a bit because it's often the sort of news sections and the sort of, you know, the Daily Mail pieces or sort of versions or comment sections where a lot of the media anger, like, focuses. Yeah.
I think most people are sympathetic to him. It's just even a small minority in a country the size of England or the UK is still a lot of people.
Yeah, but also you made the point about Emmanuel Matic, and that's true. Like, I see where you're coming from, but he's also not Irish as well, and there's no doubt the fact that McClean being Irish and probably, like, you know, not being shy about his Irish Republican beliefs, people probably struggle to get their head around that being someone's belief, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's the thing. But they're not going to be that energised by the sort of the nuances of the situation in the Balkans. You know, there's something about an Irish person who's not afraid to express, like, their Irish political views, that I think obviously that's a red rag to a bull to a lot of people.
No, it's true.
In the UK, you expect in some ways, like, they like their Irish people to be a bit more quiet about these type of things.
Yeah,
you know?
It's true. I keep referencing Ard Lohanlon, but he even mentioned, you know, Canary Wharf in 96. Like, that, he felt the effects of that in the aftermath. And so it's very different to Nemanja Matic, for sure. What about, by the way, Michael O'Neill in all this? He's his manager at Stoke. Obviously, he's going to know exactly, literally, where McClean is coming from. Has he said much?
No, probably not in recent times, but I recall him being quite supportive of him around the time when the stadiums were open, and he effectively stopped the match. But, like, Michael O'Neill's sort of an interesting one. Michael O'Neill from Portadown, like, Michael O'Neill, you know, I'm not bringing religion into it, but obviously it's, you know, the sectarian language and stuff is part of the debate
Catholic,
here.
Yeah.
You know, like, Michael O'Neill, Catholic, for Northern Ireland, and, like, you know, when Michael O'Neill would have sort of started off as Northern Ireland manager, like, you know, I think there's a quite unified approach, obviously, to some degree, in the Northern Irish team. But they've had issues there with, say, losing players to the Republic, and it's a complicated one for Michael O'Neill, I'd say, because I'd love to know, actually. You'd love to have a proper chat with him, but I suspect the microphones would have to be away from it to fully get a handle on what he feels of everything McClean has had through the years, because there's layers to their relationship, because Michael Lee would have wanted to call James McClean up, I think, you know, for Northern Ireland, but obviously he'd just gone he'd gone with his heart at that stage. But I guess I'm dancing around it. I think Michael Lee would probably respect James McClean's opinions, but obviously has probably at times in his life, you know, he's probably had to deal with things in a different way.
As in James I think
every Catholic player who's played for Northern Ireland to some degree has probably heard stuff that would be insulting to them, but obviously, you know, James McClean grow up in an area where, and, like, I've been to where he's grown up, and it's, you know, it's a particularly emotive subject to people from Craigan and who've grown up in that environment, you know. But it is funny that, like, funny is the wrong word, but that at this point in James McClean's life, he has ended up, you know, being managed by Michael O'Neill, or someone who has been through aspects of it to a degree, but is probably, you know, just from a short distance away, but has experienced a different life in aspects of it, you know?
Yeah. Well, look, we've talked about it plenty of times before. I suspect we'll talk about it plenty of times again. And it's hard to hit on any grand resolution or... you know, what's the conclusion? It's terrible, and it's probably going to continue, unfortunately, and that's where it's been for the last 9-10 years of his career, which is such a pity. Like, he should have had a you know, the most wonderful life, stress-free, away from all this crap. And, you know, he's got the winning lottery ticket, professional footballer. And instead, it's been mired in this stuff. Like, his wife sent a message to one of their two social media accounts pretty much every day.
Yeah, no, I know. And it's I think, like, you know, there's obviously, I think from his perspective, there'd probably be a lot of, like, pride in what he's done in his football career. But obviously, this is sort of something that's run in tandem with it. Now, at the same time, like, I still think, you know, he will eventually, whenever he retires, whatever he does, you know, after football, like, I still think he'll be able to go home and be very confident and feel happy that he's stood by his beliefs all the time. And it does seem like maybe there might be others who have some regrets that they didn't have the convictions that he did on occasion. Mm. But obviously, he's had to pay a price for that too. And in some respects, it'll be different personality types might assess that equation in different ways. Like, he's been very true to himself, but others would say, at what price? You know, and that's obviously that's where principle comes down to it. And I'm sure in time, I'd love all his Irish teammates. I think I'd love them in with the passing of time, probably when they're not playing. I think that's when you have the best discussion with them. Let's be honest, you know, while they're still playing, I'm not sure if they're all going to go there. If David Moyer is retired, you know, Kevin Caban spoke about it, obviously, about how he would maybe choose not to wear the poppy, but Irish lads go along with it. You'd be very interested to when all his generational players all retire, what they all have to say. Mm. And would they have done certain things differently at times?
Okay. Liverpool still 2-0 up away to Leipzig, 82 minutes on the clock. Meanwhile, at the Nou Camp, Barcelona 1, PSG 3 is the latest. So PSG have taken control of this game after going a goal down to a Lionel Messi penalty on 27 minutes. Mbappe had equalised before half-time. And now on 65 minutes, Mbappe has scored again to make it 2-1. And 5 minutes later, Moise Kean made it 3-1. So about 8 minutes to go there. It's PSG 3-1 up at the Nou Camp. Back in one sec.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Only the cream of the crop pick up Champions League medals. Jonathan Greening's got one.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Show Me the Science with Professor Luke O'Neill.
A News Talk original podcast series focusing on different issues, from the serious to the silly. All explained through science. Catch up on the podcast series at newstalk.com or on the News Talk app.
Are your employees working remotely but struggling with unreliable phone and collaboration tools? Take a free trial of Avaya Cloud Office by RingCentral at cloudoffice.ie.
This Irish success story is brought to you by Guaranteed Irish.
Home to Sean O'Casey and WB Yeats, Mountjoy Square is also home to DID Electrical's first store since 1968. Now employing 350 people in 23 stores nationwide and online at DID.ie. DID continues to deliver, install and demonstrate the latest appliances and technology. Guaranteed Irish welcomes companies that are altogether better choices for our communities. So look out for it. GuaranteedIrish.ie. Altogether better.
At ESB Networks, we keep the nation humming by connecting us all to Ireland's power network. To increase the capacity and maintain the safety of the network, we may need to temporarily switch off the electricity in your area for a short period. As always, we will let you know in advance if you're going to be affected. To find out more, visit esbnetworks.ie.
Shop online with Harvey Norman for big deals on home appliances, like the LG 10.5kg washing machine, now $549, saving $190. Or save €80 on the Samsung 8kg washer dryer, now $769, and claim €60 cashback. And at Harvey Norman, we're matching all competitors' prices, even their sale prices, so why shop anywhere else? Shop online at harveynorman.ie, or safely in our spacious stores, open until 6pm daily for home appliances and essential technology. Cashback T's and C's apply. See in store for details.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Champions League nights on Off the Ball. Bigger than Zlatan's ego. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back. So still Leipzig 0, Liverpool 2, and still, oh, in fact, it has just changed. It's now PSG 4, Barcelona 1. This is turning into, well, I was about to say decisive, but I don't want to jinx myself based on 2017, but it's looking ominous for Barcelona. It's a very different Barcelona in 2021. They're now 4-1 down. Mbappe has scored a hat-trick. Big nights, big players and all that. So Mbappe has scored in the 85th minute to put PSG 4-1 up at the Nou Camp. Liverpool still 2-0 up away to Leipzig. Meanwhile, just to mark your card, interesting times in Serie A. Juve in action tomorrow in the Champions League, but they're still struggling domestically. They are in fourth spot. They are 8 points behind Inter. AC Milan are 1 point behind Inter, first against second this weekend in Serie A. So it's proving to be a very interesting season, to say the least. Very happy to say Nicky Bandini of The Guardian and ESPN and elsewhere is with us. Nicky, how you doing?
Doing good. How are you?
Yeah, we're very good. Very good. So it has been an interesting season, to say the least. Inter against Milan this Sunday, first against second. I feel like it's the 80s again.
Yeah, I think it's a thrilling prospect, isn't it, to have the Derby della Madonnina, the not the capital city, but the biggest city in Italy, and the industrial hub of Italy, and the place that has given birth to these two teams that are neither of them quite the most successful team in Italy, because that's been Juventus, but that certainly have been two and three basically in that conversation going back forever, really, and haven't been in the last decade. So it's a thrilling prospect that one of these two could end up ending the run of nine consecutive Juventus titles. And it's even more exciting seeing them go head to head as one and two at the moment.
There's also an interesting cast of characters again. I mean, we're talking about Andrea Pirlo's Juventus, which is, you know, it's fascinating to see how he gets on. We're talking about Conte at Inter Milan. By the way, he's escaped punishment for giving the Juventus president the finger. We've got Zlatan then at 39 doing all sorts of mad things, not least getting into a mad scrap with Lukaku of Inter. So, like, there's a lot to, if you're making a living writing about Italian football right now, there's an interesting group there to pick from.
It's not the worst time to be writing about this league. I would agree with you. Obviously, you haven't even mentioned Ronaldo, who I can't pretend that him showing up was bad for business either. Look, the stuff between Agnelli and Conte the other night, which you're mentioning there with Conte not getting punished for, he showed the middle finger to his former boss, and his former boss, who, I mean, these are men in their 40s going at each other with some quite playground stuff, really, but it does add to this sense of tension and drama. And as you mentioned, Lukaku and Ibrahimovic in the cup only a few weeks ago literally squared up face to face, head to head. Ibrahimovic put his forehead into Lukaku's face and got sent off for it. They've got a mural now outside San Siro. This is how quickly the culture responds. But someone's painted this sort of graffiti-style mural that's actually beautiful of the two of them going at it. So there's lots of that. Again, if you want to be nostalgic about it, that sense of the big clubs from the 80s and 90s really feeling that tension of this title race and the Champions League situation.
So how do you see this game on Sunday, and how do you see the title race? Does it now feel as if this is very much Inter versus AC Milan, or are you expecting Juventus to come up on the outside?
I'm not going to rule out Juventus after nine consecutive league titles. I know some people want to. It's a interesting question about how well exactly they're playing, because of course they do have the Champions League game against Porto tomorrow night as well. They have only lost two games so far in this calendar year, Juventus, and those were against Napoli and Inter. They've won every other game that they've played. So they're actually in better form than Milan, for instance, who've lost, I think, four times now this year already. So there's reasons to think that Juventus are stepping forward, but they have ground to make up because they dropped points early in the season against teams like Crotone, Verona, teams you wouldn't expect them to have dropped points against in the past. And to me, there's something psychological as well about the fact that Inter, who are much more than Milan, even though Milan have led the way for most of this season, Inter, who have Conte, who've spent huge amounts of money to bring in the likes of Lukaku, of Achraf Hakimi, to develop this squad to win a title. The fact that Inter did win the league game against them in January, they now don't have to worry about Europe, so they can focus all energies on the league. To me, psychologically, I think that gives them something of an edge as well. So Juventus aren't the favourites, and that's already shocking to me, but I'm not counting them out in February, no way.
Has it emerged, was there a genuine beef between Zlatan and Lukaku that goes beyond just the realm of heat of the moment out on a pitch?
It's really hard to talk about this without really bringing up exactly the words that were said, which I don't have in front of me, of course.
They were strong.
And Ibrahimovic had this quip about, he used the word voodoo, and a lot of people interpreted that very quickly as was this a racist comment? And he's defended himself saying, look, that wasn't what that was about. And there was a story when Lukaku was at Everton, a story that was published in national newspapers about his mother going to speak to a voodoo. Now, Lukaku has rubbished all of that, said it was lies and nonsense. But I think what you definitely do get with Ibrahimovic is, he's a stirrer. Like, he loves to stir the pot, and he likes to needle, and he knows what buttons to press sometimes. And I think in his mind, in that moment, he wasn't trying to be nasty, but he was trying to get a reaction, which he did. Perhaps with hindsight, he might think he overstepped the mark. I don't think it's necessarily that the two individuals hate each other. In fact, in the past, they've spoken quite highly of each other. But okay. I do think this conversation has left a bad taste, and it won't wash away, certainly, in time for this derby.
Yeah. What about Pirlo then? What are people making of him as a manager? What's jumping out to you? Is there an early verdict in on his failings or otherwise yet?
He's getting leeway because he's Pirlo, for sure. I think if you compare just in absolutely outright terms where Juventus are now compared to where they were last season under Maurizio Sarri. Sarri was something like 6 points ahead, maybe more than that. And Sarri was not getting anything like the baby gloves treatment that Pirlo has got. So he has got a lot of inbuilt goodwill from who he is. But people are beginning to ask some questions, because he was brought in to develop a project, certainly, to bring a more attacking, ambitious style of football was always the idea. You look at the last few games, even ones that they won, like against Roma when they beat them. Roma had 14 shots in that game to Juventus' 3. There was a big reliance on get the ball to Ronaldo and let him fix it, which he did. I think people were hoping that Pirlo would be farther ahead in implementing something more ambitious than that by now. But again, I think he has got still, with fans, more leeway than he would if he was anyone else at all.
And a kind of a broader question about the league then and how it's going. I know there's issues with TV money and the pandemic has really complicated matters. But I mean, if you were to ask the casual football fan who maybe watches mostly Premier League, they obviously know Premier League football. They'd have a sense of La Liga, and it really revolves around the big two there. And the Bundesliga has an identity and its tactical sophistication and all these hotshot young managers and high pressing and all that. I think the maybe uninformed view of Serie A would be, well, it's just not what it used to be, and it's a bit kind of, I'm not too sure what its unique selling point is beyond the tradition and the big names. What's the quality of football like that we're seeing at the moment? Are things on the up? Is there a certain style that's prevalent?
I mean, first of all, I just have to take issue on behalf of everyone in Italy, because I know that I'm half Italian. I know that my Italian family would take great offence to the idea that Germany is tactically innovative and Italy isn't. I mean, Italy will always take great pride in its grooming of managers, the Coverciano manager school, and there are some great managers.
I would offend your Italian family further by saying, defensive type of football, really.
Well, go watch Spezia and Italiano. Wonderfully, his surname is literally Italiano, Italian. What he's doing at Spezia, they play a really intelligent, not gung-ho, which I think they would perceive German football as, but a really intelligent press that against Milan this weekend allowed Spezia, who have the smallest budget in the league, who have the second youngest squad in the league, to upset Milan. I think there is some really clever football played in Serie A. But to answer the broader question, which is probably more important, look, there's not a title race like this anywhere else in Europe, where you have three clubs that are really absolutely in the conversation between Milan, Inter and Juventus. And there's not a Champions League race, I don't think, as intense as what's going on in Italy at the moment, where behind that you have Napoli, Roma, Lazio, all within a couple of points of each other and all actually not really out of this title race yet. Mm. They're all, I think, within 9 points at the most of the title. Some of those teams have game in hand. It's honestly... look, of course, we've said it already. Some things are good for business, and it's good for business when people are interested in Serie A. But I think this is the most genuinely excited I've been about Serie A in probably most of the last 9 years. Yeah. So if you're not watching it, in my opinion, you're missing out.
Okay, sold. Nicky Bandini, thanks so much.
Anytime.
Great, thanks very much. Ladies in Champions League, it's full time in Leipzig. Liverpool 2-0 winners and 4-1 PSG Barcelona into added time now.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. The Champions League. We love it as much as Neymar loves himself.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
VHI Life is more than just a decision to get life insurance. It's a decision to live life with less worry, to not think twice about the financial security of your children, and to give your partner peace of mind. VHI Life. It's a good decision for life. For a quote, call 8090 44444. Terms and conditions apply. VHI Healthcare DAC trading as VHI Healthcare is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland and is tied to Zurich Life Assurance PLC for VHI Life Term Insurance.
Transform your home with the Green Hub from OnPost, a hassle-free way to upgrade to a warmer, more cost-efficient home. We'll help you with everything, even the grant process. Plus, we have the lowest green loan rate over €20,000. Visit onpost.com/greenhub or your local post office today. The Green Hub from OnPost, the easier way to enjoy greener living. Lending criteria, terms and conditions apply. Info correct as of 1st of August 2020. Source ccpc.ie for Ireland's lowest rate over €20,000. OnPost acts as a credit intermediary on behalf of Avantcard DAC. OnPost trading as OnPost Money is authorised as a credit intermediary by the CCPC. Avantcard DAC trading as Avantcard is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Only the cream of the crop pick up Champions League medals. Jonathan Greening's got one.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Dan, I hadn't realised you were still with us that whole time.
Oh, sorry, Joe. I was just watching. I was watching the football. Just feeling like, you know, being a professional. It's all right, you know. And Leipzig missed the sitter at the end. Okay. They really missed the sitter. The Korean sub missed an absolute sitter. Would have been a great chance to sort of make it interesting.
A story of the night. Barcelona. I mean, you know, nailing coffin.
Yeah, watched the wrong game.
Messi's out of there, isn't he?
I don't know. Do you ever get that watch the wrong game thing?
Yes.
I definitely watched the wrong game. Kept an eye on Leipzig Liverpool.
Mbappe with a hat trick.
Big mistake.
That seems like a big night in his career.
Yeah, it's sort of a while since he's had one. Do you know what I mean? In the sense that after 2018, you're expecting him to maybe go and join that, like to keep doing it all the time when he's had his issues. But what a night to do it.
Yeah,
Pochettino and all as well. It's a good story. But Barca, I mean, I suppose the league table in Spain probably isn't lying to some degree.
Yeah. So, look, we're pretty much done for the evening. OTB AM live as usual tomorrow, 7:30. James McClean's going to be on the show, if you didn't hear that earlier on. So I think James is going to be on around 9 o'clock. Cuiva O'Neill and Niall Quinn also on tomorrow morning. And then tomorrow night, we'll have Wednesday Night Rugby as usual. Padraig Carrington's going to join us. Obviously, came down with COVID, 10, 12 days ago now. Seems to have come through it well. He's going to play this week. He's out of isolation tomorrow, I think. So we're going to get Padraig Carrington on the show from LA tomorrow. In the meantime, Richie is on the way for Tom Dunn next. Dan McDonnell, pleasure as always. Thank you.
Thanks, Joe.
Give him a ball and he out of grass. He'll give you a move for the perfect pass. Give him a ball and he out of space. He'll give you a move with guiltly grace. Ra-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. He's a nice young man. It's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. It's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. It's a lovely smile. He's a nice young man. It's a lovely smile. Stand a mile. Give the ball and he had a glass. He'll give you a move with guiltly grace.
gift you make for the perfect car. Get the ball and the outer spikes. Don't get you move with your blinker eyes. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss his friends. A man can have that great and lovely good night to miss his friends.
Extra, our email newsletter straight to your inbox. Sign up now at newstalk.com/extra.
Discover a world of film you won't find anywhere else with IFI at Home, the Irish Film Institute's online streaming service. Explore exciting new releases, independent film.